non-nuclear deal. Leaders from UK, France, Russia, Iran are all vowing to stay in the deal despite Mr. Trump's announcement. So what does this mean for the administration's effort to broker a new deal? Joining us now is Andrew Peak, the State Department's Deputy Assistant Secretary for Iraq and Iran. Good to have you on, sir.
Thanks so much.
Now, let me jump topics just for one second, because frankly, it matters to me more in the moment. Do you have any information we can share with the audience about the chance that those Americans that are held in North Korea are going to come home with Mike Pompeo?
I don't. I'm sorry.
Is that because there is no development, or you're just being sensitive to the situation?
You know, I'm the Iran official. I can't speak to the North Korean developments.
All right, I got you. Thanks. I wanted to ask because, you know, that matters. I get that it's being used as a little bit of a political device, and there's good and bad reason for that, but I just wanted to ask, thank you for going on the record about it. All right, now back to what your bailiwick is. Why are my kids and Americans and their children more safe because of what the president just did?
Well, I think reimposing the sanctions that were lifted under the JCPOA allows us to better counter the totality of Iran's malign behavior in the region. You know, not just get to a place where we have better nuclear safeguards, but helpfully roll back Iran's support of terrorism, push back on its support of proxies, and reduce Iran's proliferation of missiles. All of these activities are contributing to a situation that's making the region less safe since the deal's been signed.
Understood. But if the concern is their other activities, why take away the protections that are in place right now against their arguably most dangerous potential, which is the nuclear deal? You have protections on that now. Why take those away in order to address their other nefarious activities in the region?
Well, because the problem with the nuclear deal, as the president laid out, was that it essentially decoupled the economic consequences from Iranian behavior, right? It broke that basic dialectic where the Iranians would act one way and the international community would effectively push back on that. It essentially cordoned off this huge part of the Iranian economy. Whereas whatever else it did, it was essentially unsanctionable because of Iran's nuclear behavior. And so because of that, you saw Iranian behavior steadily get worse.
If you wanted to sanction them for their other behavior, non-nuke related, let's say, Tim Kaine says you had that authority. You were given it a year ago in the bundle sanctions for Iran, Russia, and North Korea. You could have sanctioned them for what they're doing in the region. You chose not to.
That's preposterous. We sanctioned about seven times as many entities in 2017 as 2016. Iranian entities, yeah. We have used our sanctions authority aggressively to push back on Iranian influence. Our predisposition at this point is to push back on those activities. But the problem is there are entities that are essentially what I would consider dual use. They have ties to the nuclear sector, but also ties to, let us say, the IRGC. And worse than that, the nuclear deal actually, in effect, mandated a top line of investment in the Iranian economy, almost regardless of its other behavior. That's the decoupling that so concerns us.
If sanctions aren't enough, because, you know, Tim Kaine says you had the ability to sanction, you're saying you've sanctioned more than was ever done before in this regard. Then in 2016, then maybe President Trump was right back in 2011 when he tweeted that sanctioning Iran is not enough to stop them with their nuclear capabilities, or now as an extension of that logic, or their nefarious activities in the region, that sanctions isn't enough.
Well, I think the president's right that we need a really comprehensive political and economic sanctions effort with our allies to combat Iran, to reduce Iran's malign influence. But I think if you look at where we are in 2013 with a crushing economic pressure on Iran, we saw that that was effective, that the Iranians would bargain when that was applied. And so the idea is to reapply that and, frankly, get a better deal across the totality of Iranian behavior than what we had, than what we eventually settled for in the JCPOA.
All right, so there are obstacles to that. The first one is that the other parties say they don't want to go along with you on that. They want to stay in this current deal and that they're going to rework it with Iran themselves without the U.S. Does that concern you?
Look, this is an iterative process. This is kind of diplomacy 101. We have had about two decades of experience with secondary sanctions, that is, sanctions under entities not under U.S. jurisdiction. The best way to reduce foreign investment in Iran in designated entities and sectors of the Iran economy is by cajoling, encouraging, at times prodding. We're confident we're going to get there, and I think Rick Grenell, our new ambassador to Germany, said the same thing just yesterday. We're going to reduce investment in Iran, in problematic entities, and its energy sector. Just, it'll take some diplomacy.
Big part of the president's argument here is, can't trust Iran. Iran's going to have nukes just around the corner, and they're not keeping the deal. The IAEA says that's not true. Secretary Mattis said in congressional testimony that that's not true. Is that a good basis to go into this move by having the president make statements about Iran's noncompliance that are contradicted by his own Secretary of Defense and by the monitoring agency involved?
Well, you know, I'll let the Secretary of Defense do his own interviews. I'll say it is the administration's position that there were grave flaws in the JCPOA. The president was quite right.
Well, no,
for
not
example,
in the deal,
access
in the compliance,
to military sites.
In the compliance,
well,
sir.
For access to military sites. That was a gaping hole that we needed to see filled. And frankly, I think we're going to get to a place where we can do that.
But the IAEA says that they are in compliance with the deal as it stands. They have more monitoring. They have more eyes on the ground in Iran than we've ever had before.
But again, that's not sufficient because of the lack of access to the military sites, because of the sunset provisions, because of the lack of ICBM provisions. It was not a sufficient deal, even what we have.
So we heard the president cite Israeli intelligence as a basis of this understanding of what we have to worry about with Iran. No citing of U.S. intelligence and no echo effect from any of the other allies who have their own capable intelligence apparatuses. Nobody shares the opinion that the president put out there. Why?
The president's getting information from all U.S. intelligence agencies.
He only cited the Israeli intelligence, Bibi Netanyahu's case.
I can tell you that the president's getting information from all U.S. and foreign intelligence agencies, all U.S. intelligence agencies and a range of foreign ones.
Why would the U.K. and France, Germany, you know, other allies in the area, whether signatories or not, why would they not want to step up and affirm this? This is a threat to everybody, not just the United States.
I can only repeat what I just said. I would defer comment on those countries, what they share publicly from their intelligence communities to them. I will say that the president's fully aware of the relevant information on the Iranian nuclear program.
So here's where it stands. Right now, until you get something better, assuming they can't salvage this deal among the remaining signatories in Iran, we have nothing. Should we be concerned?
Well, first of all, Iran's behavior across the spectrum concerns me every day. I mean, that's what I do for a living. I think they concerns many of our regional allies and many of our European allies as well.
Right, but freeing frankly, them from the current constraints doesn't make us more safe, unless you replace it with something
more
better,
safe.
Right?
No, it certainly makes us more safe.
How so?
Look, this is going to be a cost-benefit decision and analysis at multiple iterative points in 3 months, in 6 months, in 12 months, but when, you know, going forward in the future. We have every confidence that by making this decision that we are imposing sufficient leverage to get Iran to reduce its activities, to put better pressure on Iran to get
right
to a better place with regards to the balance of power in the region and Iran's nuclear activities.
But until you do that, we will be left with nothing if the remaining allies and signatories can't keep the deal intact.
No, we certainly wouldn't be left with nothing because Iran would be reducing its activities. I mean, this is the
entire
goal of what. Well, if we see it, then we'll be positive about it.
Right, right? But I don't know. I understand your wait and see analysis. I'm saying, in the instant situation that we're in, assuming they can't salvage the deal themselves, you would have no extra monitoring. You would have no extra checks on their nuclear capabilities until you put something else in place. That's just
a matter of fact. Well, that's not what the Iranians have said yet, right? They haven't said that that's where they're going. They've been ambiguous about that. Frankly, there's
still
signatories.
People in the streets burning the American flag and chanting death to the United States.
Well,
if what you're banking on is the good faith of the Iranians that you just did dirty on the deal, that's a little bit of a specious premise, no?
Well, that's nothing new in the last 24 hours. The Iranians are burning flags and chanting death to America. I think, frankly, that's one of the reasons that any sort of good faith deal with the Iranians in 2015 was so problematic to take, you know, on the face of it.
Well, that's why it wasn't based on good faith. It was actually based on bad faith. I remember that rhetoric at the time. A troubling situation. Appreciate you making the case, Mr. Peek. Very helpful to the audience.